Okay, so I think we're ready to start. I'm not sure if the microphones are on yet, but I'll shout so you can hear me at the back. I'm Mary Riddell. It's a huge pleasure to welcome you all here this morning to this great event run under the banner of Political Women Have More in Common and held, of course, in honour of Jo Cox. We have with us today representatives of her family, her foundation, the Jo Cox Foundation, our keynote speaker, Julia Gillard, whom we're delighted to welcome, and of course, all of you. I wanted just to start by saying a few words about Jo. I was lucky enough to be able to say that she was a good friend of mine and somebody whose memory is as vivid, I think, as it has been for the last weeks and months, which have been terribly difficult for, of course, all those who were very close to her. But what rests of Jo, what remains of Jo, is that sense of fun and of lightheartedness, combined with the utter seriousness about issues which preoccupied her and which she was passionate about. She was all the things and more that have been talked about in the tributes. She was a wonderful MP, campaigner, wife, mother. But most of all, she was absolutely stalwart in the causes she defended. I thought of her again this morning, as I do most mornings, with the announcement of the debate in the House of Commons on Syria this afternoon, and how she would have been such a huge part of that, and how missed she is every day by family, friends, and colleagues. One of her legacies I know she would wish to have is to pursue her quest of getting more women into public life, and that's, of course, really why we're here today. She wouldn't, I think, despite the great ease with which she appeared to have reached her place in life and to have gone about her day-to-day business, she wouldn't want anyone else to think it was easy. Some weeks ago, Brendan, her husband, who's with us today, organised a wonderful memorial service at the family home on the Welsh borders. And as part of that, a clip was played from a Radio Leeds Desert Island disc, in which Jo spoke about how she left her working class background, her sort of ordinary comprehensive school, to go to Pembroke College, I think, in Cambridge, and how difficult she found it there to be transplanted to a completely different milieu, somewhere where she felt so out of place that she wondered at times if she could withstand the pressure. Of course, she got through that with all that followed, but I think she realised, as perhaps everyone in this room realises, that to make a success of life, particularly perhaps if you're a woman, means that at times you have to overcome obstacles that seem too daunting. You have to cope with fear, sometimes with rejection, with insecurity. All of those, I think, are common to us all, and that was something that Jo understood perfectly. There are, however, other people, often women, who are only too happy to help, to encourage people who are starting out. We're lucky enough to have with us today speakers who absolutely fulfill that description. Most of them women, but we have some men as well. What I'm going to do is introduce them one by one, ask them to come up on stage and talk very briefly, not more than 5 minutes, because otherwise I'll overrun and we will really run out of time. But I think we've got most of our speakers here, so I wonder if I could start by asking if Sam Smethers would join me. Sam is the... Do come up, please, Sam. So, by way of very brief introduction, Sam, as you know, is the chief executive of the Fawcett Society. She's been there since last year, former CEO of Grandparents Plus, and we're delighted to have her as our introductory speaker.
Thank you, Mary. Good morning, everybody. Can I just say, obviously, it's really an honour to be here to be speaking in memory of Jo and a focus on practical action, which I know very much that she would have welcomed. So thank you very much. So the Fawcett Society, we have 150 years of campaigning for women's rights and gender equality, and that's our focus. It's campaigning for change, structural change. We've campaigned to get all women's shortlists, for example, working with all the political parties to improve women's representation in those parties. And so our focus is on that structural change that we need to see. And you're going to hear from some fantastic speakers who are focused very much on encouraging women to come through, and so it's not taking anything away from that. But we have to have those structural solutions because it cannot be simply about fixing the women. It has to be about changing the system that they come into. So what do we know about women's representation? About 29% of our MPs are women, 35% of the cabinet, 33% of our local councillors, and about 15% of council leaders. And when you look at Parliament in particular, we've just had a very thorough review of parliamentary practice by Professor Sarah Childs, and she identifies three main areas of focus. One is about that equality of participation, so how you identify and get women in all their diversity to come through to represent political parties. And one is also about the parliamentary infrastructure, so what system do they encounter when they get there? For example, 45% of our women in Parliament are not mothers, whereas 28% of male MPs are not fathers. So we've got a disproportionate number of women who can't really combine motherhood with being in Parliament. And speaking about this in a debate last year, Jo said, it is important to make the House of Commons a beacon of best practice. We should be ahead of the game, not behind the curve, which is where I feel that we currently are. After 5 months here, it does not feel like a very family-friendly place. If we act differently and change the culture and working practices here, we can change how others operate. We should do that because we are here to change and improve the United Kingdom. And thinking about that culture, we've got a very male-dominated culture in Parliament, we know that, and it's sometimes misogynistic culture, I would argue. But it isn't only Parliament that's got a problem. We're running a commission on women in local government at the moment, and one of the councillors giving evidence to that commission last week said that as a lead member for Children's Services in Birmingham, she was told that she would have to leave her job if she became pregnant because they didn't have a maternity policy. Now that's in 2016, and that's what we're saying to women who stand up to represent us. And coming down the track, we've got boundary changes, reducing the number of seats from 650 to 600, and we've done an analysis of those initial changes, and we will actually see women's representation go backwards by 2020. So 100 years after we celebrate the vote, 100 years after we mark the first women in Parliament, we will probably see our women go down, not up, in 2020. We are 48th in the world at the moment. Of all the countries that have got 30% or more women's representation, 80% of them have used some form of quota. So we cannot rely on a meritocracy to get women there. So what's my call to action to you today? Put simply, support each other. Support each other wherever you see women speaking out, in meetings, in public life, online. Don't allow anyone to shout them down. Don't allow anyone to crowd them out. We have to support women into public life because the barriers they will face and the obstacles they will face are many and significant. And at the moment, there is a real risk that women will be deterred from entering public life because of the treatment they get when they get there. And finally, a quote from Millicent Fawcett, the founder of our charity, she said, "Justice and freedom for women are things worth securing, not only for their own sakes, but for civilization itself." Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sam. So for anyone else in this room who wants to follow, perhaps in Jo's footsteps to represent the people of this country in Parliament, there's a crying need for you. Our next speaker is Ruth Hunt. She's the Chief Executive of Stonewall, She's done a large amount of groundbreaking work, not least leading Stonewall's fantastic work to stamp out homophobic bullying in schools.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm going to talk about three things. The first, my experience of being a chief exec as a woman and some of the things that I wish someone had told me. Second, some of the things that Stonewall are doing to try and eradicate the institutional inequalities that exist across every major institution and aspect of our society. And third, the things that I think you can do differently. First, as CEO, I've worked at Stonewall for 11 years. I've been chief exec for two. And I can absolutely tell you that when a woman has a view, how she speaks, how she looks when she says it, how she sounds and how she presents it, are always more of interest than the actual comment that she has made. And it has taken me probably 2 years to develop a sufficient resilience and awareness of that's what's going on every time I express a view, to find my voice in the same way I had when I was a brash, very new CEO who had the confidence to say what I wanted when I wanted it. Second, do not deny the impact that that kind of aggression has on your ability to find your voice and speak your opinion. However much we might say externally it's water off a duck's back, it doesn't matter. Of course it does. It leaves a mark, and therefore tackling that mark is incredibly important. The third thing I've learned is that it's okay to be clever, it's okay to be articulate, it's okay to have views, and it's okay to express those views. And as women, we routinely forget that it's okay to be clever, it's okay to be articulate, and it's okay to express views. So one of the things I wish I'd held on to when I first became CEO, and I was surprised by the level of institutional and organisational misogyny that dominates any British discourse, is I wish I'd held on to that a little more closely. What does Stonewall do? Stonewall does everything in its power as a lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender charity to eradicate inequalities. We work with 750 employers, 2,000 schools and as many individuals as we can. And what we do is we empower them. And we take women, and we take lesbian and bisexual women, and we take trans women, and we take gay men, and we teach them to have the power to take control of their individual circumstances, to influence wherever they live, work, socialise, play and pray. And 1,000 of those people have come through our programmes in the last year. And what we're struck by is that political actions don't have to be necessarily parliamentarian or party. One can make a huge difference in one's local setting as long as we look beyond our peripheral vision and see how we can influence beyond our own sphere. And that means for us at Stonewall shifting the gay rights movement from what about me to what about us. And if we can get the gay men to care about the Asian lesbians living in Yorkshire, then we will be successful in our efforts. So that leads to my third point about what we can do. We have to look beyond ourselves. And any movement of empowerment and any movement of liberation that only relies on our own success and our own ambition is fundamentally flawed. There's a lot of discussion about intersectionality, which is a complex academic term that means nothing to anybody. Bottom line, there will always be people who have less power than you. And the answer is not to say we're going to put more seats around the table. We would like to invite more people around our table. It's to redesign the table and to give up power. And the thing that most people struggle with, the most empowered, the most feminist, the most enlightened, the most socialist, is giving up power. And so I would urge you today is think about how you can relinquish control over something and give it to someone who has less power than you. Thank you.
Ruth, thank you very much for that fantastically inspiring message about empowerment. Simon Woolley is our next speaker. He's one of the, do come up please, he's one of the founders and the director of Operation Black Vote, with which I think most of you will be familiar. He's done absolutely fantastic work with BME communities across the country. We welcome him.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to what I see to be a great event. I'm actually coming on behalf of Rita Patel. Rita Patel has been chair of Operation Black Vote for 20 years. Unfortunately, she couldn't come today, so I'm her substitute. But I do want to talk about empowerment. I do want to talk about empowerment for women. and for black and minority ethnic communities, because we've been working in that area, on that field, for over 20 years. And just to emphasize how critically important it is. Our focus, of course, is with black and minority ethnic communities, black communities, as we broadly say. But when I'm trying to convince institutions, when I'm trying to convince the political elite, I often use the gender argument to gain traction about what I want to say. Because sometimes if you just talk about race, race equality, the shutters come down, that people think, here he goes again, we're just not interested. So I have to be smart. And I guess, as your previous speakers have suggested, you as women have to be smart to break down the persistent barriers. So what I say to wider audiences, to black men and women, I say that we'd like a voice as black people. And of course, you as women have had to fight for that voice. And for centuries, that men have said, your place is best place in the kitchen, looking after the kids. And you've had to fight. You've had to fight to say, you go in the kitchen. You look after the kids as well. And when you've won that battle, I say to these audiences, and you're still fighting it, when you've won that battle, a fantastic thing happens. Because when you are around those decision-making tables, I would argue a number of things happen. When you're there, I say to the audience, you bring a dynamism that isn't there unless you're there. A dynamism of struggle, a dynamism of having to battle against the odds. You bring a history of oppression that only you have faced. And I think also that you bring a sensibility. When Jo Cox spoke in the House of Commons about the refugee crisis, and she spoke as a woman, she spoke as a mother, it was almost as though it was only her brand of sensibility that could go through the white noise of this isn't important. You bring all those things to the table that are not there unless you're there. It's a game changer, a dramatic game changer. But what I say is this. For those same reasons that you deserve to be at the table, we black people deserve to be at the same table too. Because when we are there, we bring a history of slavery, colonialism, oppression, survival, dignity. We bring that to the table. We bring a dynamism, a black dynamism. I can't explain it. Abina's at the back there. She's one of our alumni Operation Black Vote. She brings that dynamism to the table when she's around a local authority as a legislator. And we bring a sensibility. You know, when I was listening to the 2008 presidential elections, I kept thinking to myself, what is the difference between Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton? They both would have made history. Let's hope Hillary Clinton makes history. But what was that black sensibility difference? And it seemed to me as though, no disrespect to Clinton, I desperately wanted to win, but it seemed to me that when she was speaking, she wanted America's vote. But when Obama spoke, it seemed to me he wanted the hearts and minds of America. And it's that sensibility that transforms the discussions when we're at the table. So I hope today, in the next few hours, that you enjoy this special place, this special space to talk about our issues. But I hope that when you walk out this door, that you walk out this door 10 feet tall. 10 feet tall as we describe in the black discourse, as warriors. as warriors for social and racial and gender justice. Thank you very much.
Simon, thank you very much. And I think anyone in this room who's sat round a meeting table and seen nothing but white male faces will identify completely with that message of justice. So on to our next speaker, Jess Thomas, who is from Campaign Boot Camp, where she's the head of operations and programs, somebody hugely experienced in feminist organizing and campaigning. We're delighted that you're here.
Thanks, Ali. Hi, everyone. I just want to start by saying that I'm really proud to be here sharing this platform with so many amazing organizations that are working hard to make sure that all women's voices are heard. I had the honor of working with Jo at Labour Women's Network, and it was really inspiring to be around someone whose passion for supporting women in public life was so infectious. And again, it's uplifting to see this room so full and know that that's being continued. So I'm here to talk about Campaign Boot Camp. We run a year-long training program. Through our training, we're building a community of campaigners that have the confidence, skills, and resilience to tackle what we think are the biggest issues of our time. Inequality of opportunity, poverty, environmental degradation, unaccountability of our institutions, and discrimination in all forms. At Boot Camp, we believe that the best change agents are those with direct experience of inequality and injustice. And we know from our training room, and I think we probably all know here in this room, that women bear the brunt of these impacts of these issues. Being a woman of colour and or having a disability, invisible or otherwise, further amplifies these impacts. And we don't want to ignore that when we talk about who we see sitting in our seats of power and who's shaping our public discourse. We think that expertise should come from those with recent experience of enacting change. Boot Camp was created in 2013 because we felt the emergent model of digital campaigning was leaving some voices aside. And we know that this is definitely a gender issue. Women's voices are routinely shut down and shouted down online, and that matters when it comes to campaigning. So in 2016, Campaign Boot Camp has trained 105 people. 76 of those graduates identify as female, and 50% of those are women of colour. And that's something I'm really proud of, and it's something that definitely influences the conversations that we're able to have in our training room. We have built a space that's focused on two key values, diversity and excellence. And our year-long program starts with an incredibly intensive six-day residential course. Sanisha from Stonewall just came on our boot camp. I think she's found it exhausting, but exciting. And we're working on three things through our training. We want to build confidence, so we bring together a diverse range of campaigners, but we value each voice equally, meaning we're able to learn from each other. We train by doing, so everyone has a chance to put into practice what they're learning. We're building skills, which means that people are in the room learning to code and building websites. They work on campaign strategy, working with the media, and importantly, collaboration, so how to work together in coalitions. And I think most importantly, we're building resilience. So we have focused on the importance of self-care and mental health through our entire program. And importantly for me on my journey and what I really enjoy seeing at Boot Camp is friendships and relationships are built in the training room and grow far afterwards. And it means that boot campers leave ready to use their voice, knowing that there is a community that's listening. So I only have 5 minutes. I've got loads of examples that I could have used, but I'm going to use a really quick case study of one of our boot campers. So there was a woman called Rebecca Bunce, who came to boot camp in 2014. After she left boot camp, she teamed up with another boot camper called Robin Boosie, and they ran a campaign to stop gender-based violence. That project turned into the IC Change campaign to get the Istanbul Convention adopted. They have influenced policy, and they were name-checked by Obama. And as an organization, we feel like that's a huge success. Thank you. there are many more, but I just want to use that one. So the thing that I want to finish with is the thing I'm really, really proud of at Campaign Boot Camp is the community and network that really flourishes around us. We all know this, but Jo said we have more in common than divides us. At Boot Camp, we're trying to build a community that recognises difference and uses that difference as the basis of our common ground. The activist Audre Lorde said, without community, there is no liberation, but community must not mean a shedding of our differences. We're building a space to do this and want to welcome others in. So if you're already a woman in a position of power, please look around and notice who is not there and make space. Women often don't self-elect, but wait to be asked. So please pull others up with you. I want to invite everyone here to join our community. We run a mentoring program for all of our boot campers. We want to invite you to look on the website, become a mentor and support and learn from the women in our community. And a simple thing you can do, which often is not done, we find at boot camp, is if you're working in any way to push for change, call yourself a campaigner and wear that badge proudly. And I want to finish by just saying a really special thank you to everyone that's organised this event so quickly and so well, and it's really exciting to be part of it. We've definitely got something to learn about organising, community and tenacity from you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jess, for that really important point. I think so often people look only at the women who floated to the top of public life, not realising in far too many cases that without that work in the community and at the grassroots, change is absolutely never going to happen. So good luck with all that. Our next speaker is Yvette Cooper, MP. I could talk for hours about stuff she's done, but as today is the International Day of the Girl, I'll focus on the fantastic work she's done on refugees, on child refugees, an issue where the British political class has been grossly negligent, and Yvette has done so much to counter that, and we're delighted to have her with us today.
Thank you, Mary, and it's just fantastic to be at a great event to honour Jo and remember Jo, but also all of her work, which is actually about inspiring women for the future. I just want to just say a few things about the work that we've been doing, an organisation that we've set up called Reclaim the Internet. And we started it just before Christmas last year, and it was in response to concern about rising misogyny online, online abuse, rape threats online. It wasn't supposed to be about politics or public life. It was actually in response to concern about teenagers being bullied online, or women facing just misogyny, or unions who told us about people working in public service jobs who are experiencing sexist or racist harassment online. And it was a building together to build together a different network of organisations. And then increasingly, actually, it became clear that politics and public life and public debate was really at the heart of it as well, because this was affecting all of our public debates too. And it was when you had the kind of advice that women were being given to say, well, look, if you can't cope with it, then just go offline. Or if you don't like it, well, it's just what you expect. Just ignore it. Don't worry about it. And I actually realized that was kind of similar to what women have been told for decades about, don't go out on the street after dark, or don't go to particular places if you're going to be worried about getting harassed or being abused or being wound up. And we took inspiration from the Reclaim the Night marches that started in Britain, started in the late 70s, and the first march in Britain was in Leeds in the late 70s, because it was a time of the Yorkshire Ripper. And the police were under pressure because they'd had a long time and they weren't finding any leads. And the advice that they gave women at the time was, don't go out after dark. And women decided instead to go out after dark and to go out together and to reclaim the streets and to reclaim the night, because actually we needed to change attitudes. We needed to get the police to do more. We needed to get the local council to put proper street lighting up. We needed to change people's expectations about what was acceptable. We needed to change the law. We needed to change the way the country worked rather than expecting that you had to change women instead. And given that the internet is our new streets, This is our new pubs and clubs and our social media. It is our new way of living. And we shouldn't tolerate that expectation that somehow women should change or women should stay off the streets. Women shouldn't stay off the new streets either and shouldn't have to stay offline. And so what we've done so far was pull together a series of different organisations like Stonewall and CST and Tell Mama and the Fawcett Society, Twitter, Google, Facebook, trade unions, employers, different organisations, political parties, talking about what we should all of us be doing and what we can do as individuals to make space safe again for people to be to have the post debates and to understand that freedom of speech has also got to be about making sure that other people's voices aren't drowned out and we can do both. What then, I'm conscious of the shortness of time, what then can everybody do ourselves is look, partly join us and be part of the Reclaim the Internet movement. Just sign up on the webpage and on Facebook, not because we know what the answers are, but actually because we don't. And because this is all so new and so fast changing that actually you need everybody's ideas and everybody's inspiration about how we do it. We will be setting out new things that we can do on campaigning for proper education around online abuse to be part of compulsory sex and relationship education in schools, which we still need to get, to be getting the internet organisations and social media companies to put more investment into safety and into tackling abuse, because it is a tiny, tiny portion of their investment that goes into it, but also doing things like the Stonewall No Bystanders campaign and actually thinking about what each of us as individuals can do. If you see somebody else who is facing abuse or being targeted on Twitter or on Facebook, report it and actually say something, make the companies do their job and deal with the abuse, don't just ignore it, and also say something nice. Say something nice to somebody who might be being targeted as well. So I think actually there are a lot of things we can do. We none of us know all the answers. There are a lot of things we can do, and to remember at the moment, actually, the online space can also be used for incredible, fantastic campaigns, for work like Everyday Sexism, for work like the hashtag Ain't No Muslim Bruv, and all those sorts of grassroots campaigns that can use the online, and we need to use those social media and not be pushed off using them because a small minority target people with organised abuse. We can stand up against it, but we can only do so if we do so together and if we do so in exactly the same way that the Reclaim the Night movement did so many years ago. Thank you.
Thank you, Yvette. And stamping out online abuse and that ugly strand that's emerged in recent years in British public life is, of course, a hugely important part of remembering Jo and taking action on exactly the sort of issues that Yvette's highlighted. So thank you very much. And we move on to our next speaker, to Nan Sloan, who's the director of the Centre for Women and Democracy in Leeds. She's a distinguished author, somebody who's played an enormous part in organising today's event, and I thank her for that and for all her work. Now.
Thank you very much. Ironically, since I'm going to speak about women's voices, as you can hear, I'm losing my own. So hopefully we'll get through. As Hillary Clinton has said on more than one occasion, words matter, and they do. And that's why this year the Centre for Women and Democracy published a collection of women's political quotations called In Our Own Words. It's an attempt to even up the scores a little and to give male compilers of books of quotations the opportunity to include women's voices, because at the moment they seem to have a bit of a problem. The Oxford Dictionary of Political Quotations, for instance, has contributions from 1,466 individuals. I like numbers. 136 of them are women. Another compilation published in the last few years has more contributions from fictional male characters than from actual real women. The absence of the political voices of women, both historic and contemporary, from recorded political culture feeds perceptions that women are less able speakers and writers, less likely to have significant or even witty insights into politics, power, or government. It robs us of part of our hinterland, denies us access to the words of many remarkable women, and means that most women politicians are forgotten much more quickly than their male counterparts. And we know too that women of colour, or women who are disabled or young or working class or LGBT, are even more likely to be silenced or rendered invisible. History has, until very recently, been written by men, and journalists and commentators were, until very recently, predominantly men, so that as a result, the voices that were seen as worthy of being recorded or remembered were almost always other men. And when you look at women who actually do make it into the collections, it's clear that they're judged differently. Many women politicians, even long-standing heads of state, appear to speak more about their experiences as women than as legislators or policymakers. There's nothing wrong with that in itself, of course, but why should a female political leader in the Balkans be interesting when she speaks about her experience of being the first or only woman, but not when she speaks about rising nationalism or the refugee crisis or the effects of the 2008 crash? In some cases, what is recorded is downright nasty. The exchanges of Nancy Astor and Bessie Braddock with Winston Churchill, for instance, often repeated as humorous banter, actually serve no real purpose other than to show off Churchill's misogyny. Now, you might ask, why does all this matter? It matters because it results in the amplification of male political voices and the diminution or marginalisation of women's. It matters because if women politicians, commentators and campaigners are seen as being confined to certain styles and issues, they are by implication excluded from others. It matters because women have as many interesting and pertinent things to say about war as they have about peace, and as much right to be heard on foreign policy as on what it's like to be a woman in a man's world. It matters because unless women hear other women's political voices, they are less likely to believe that a political life is for them. And it matters because unless we positively challenge the perception that a woman's voice is somehow weaker or less valuable or simply less interesting than a man's, we consent to the silencing of all women's voices in debates across all formats, as well as just in collections of quotations. So this is what I would like to ask you to do, apart from buy the book, of course, which is available through all good online retailers at a very reasonable price. Wherever you go, amplify women's voices. If you want to illustrate a point in a document or an article or a speech, go out of your way to find a woman's quotation to do it with. If you hear a woman say something apposite or thought-provoking, repeat it any way you can. And if nothing else, email it to me for inclusion in the second edition, which will be out in a few years. Be positive in picking women's voices up and magnifying them, sometimes even if you disagree with them. Because if we believe that our voices have an equal worth with men's, and that our experience of politics is at least as memorable as men's, and just as much worth preserving, then this is what we must do. After all, as Madeleine Albright said, this is a different quotation from the one that is immediately in all your heads. It took me a long time to develop a voice, and now that I have it, I am not going to be silent. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Nan, and good luck with that. I can assure you that despite great progress, the stereotyping battle still hasn't been quite won in newspapers, at least. So the work you do there is hugely welcome. We're going to move on now to Vicky Booth, who is co-director of the Parliament Project, an organisation, of course, which is dedicated to helping women who want to go into public life. Over to you.
Thank you. So I just want to start, as many of the rest of the speakers have, by saying thank you so much for inviting me to speak here today. It really is an utter honour to speak alongside these distinguished speakers and colleagues. So I've been working for many years within political parties, in my case within the Liberal Democrats, on the representation of women in politics. And in that time, I've worked with, I think, probably hundreds of potential women candidates who want to stand. Now, we know, I think we all know, that there are huge numbers of women out there with the skills, the talent, and the ambition to stand for elected office. I meet them all the time, and I don't just mean within my working life. I meet them, I mean, if you just have a moment to think, if whether it's your sister or a friend or your mum or somebody you meet at a party that just has got that spark, and you just think, or maybe you can see it within yourself already, you just think, you know what, they could give question time a really good go, you know? You just, and I find that very inspiring. But one of the key things that I find time and time again when I meet these people is not necessarily why they want to go into politics, because many of them have already got that vision of the world they'd like to see or the problem they'd like to solve. But the question is often how, when, who would help, what could I do to get myself in the best position, what skills do I need? These questions about what it is to become an elected representative, which is just not out there. Now, many of the political parties do provide support for women within the political parties themselves, and I know that the speakers that are coming after me are going to talk a little bit more about that in their specific parties. But for those who are not part of a political party yet, it is often very difficult to find out how you go about becoming an MP or a councillor, let alone what it takes to actually get there. And it's difficult to seriously imagine yourself in one of those jobs without knowing what that journey would entail. So we drew inspiration for the Parliament Project from an American initiative called the White House Project, which is now called Vote, Run, Leave. Lead, sorry. Vote, Run, Lead. Should have thought that through. And as they've seen considerable success in providing a gateway for women into mainstream politics. Their research has shown that just by actively encouraging women to come forward means that they are much more likely to go on to stand. So the Parliament Project is a non-partisan gateway to politics. It creates a space for women to explore their political ambition, to understand what the roles involve, to get inspired, and to network with other women that want to do the same thing. We started off at the beginning of this year. We've held two major launch events already in Edinburgh and in London, which attracted over 250 women. We've run our first pilot session on finding your political career, and one of those will be run in London in November. And we've run another event in Edinburgh to encourage people to stand as councillors. So these training and development opportunities, we intend to expand it all over the UK. We've got big ambitions. So we've got one planned in London, and when after that in Manchester. And in addition to identifying your political ambition, we also are going to run key skills sessions on the things that women say stop them putting themselves forward, things like public speaking skills, campaigning skills, etc. And from next month, we'll also be piloting peer support networks, facilitating regular meetings or conversations between small groups of women at similar points in their political careers to create those support networks which are so vital for moving forward. And as one of the most important things, we'll be providing opportunities to hear from exciting and inspiring women politicians who have already chosen to stand, because there is absolutely nothing like hearing the huge variety of personal stories and motivations which actually brought people into politics to make you understand and think that it could be you. We've got a fantastic cross-party board of advisors, including Nan Sloan and Anne Jenkin, who will be talking shortly. So we do have links into all of the political parties. So it's a gateway position where we can bring people in. And then if you want to continue your career into one of those political parties and you want to be given contacts, we have those for you. So, in terms of my action, I really hope that many of you are here today because you may be at the beginning of your political journey or perhaps some way through it. I've got two sneaky actions because one doesn't really count. One is to follow us on Twitter to find out about the future activities. And the second one is please, if it's not you, please find one woman today and ask her to run for election. It could be the person sitting beside you now. Thank you very much.
thank you, Vicky. Totally second that fantastic challenge. So we're moving on now to Olivia Bailey, who's chair of the Labour Women's Network, and she's also been research director of the Fabian Society, a long-standing stalwart of the Labour Party and Labour movement. Over to you.
Thank you. I must be getting old. I'm being called a stalwart. I just turned 30, so maybe not that old. It's a pleasure to be here to represent the Labour Women's Network, which is the organisation which campaigns for women's power and agency within the Labour Party. Jo was the first ever elected chair of the Labour Women's Network, and with her typical passion and drive made us the organisation that we are today. She was a proud Labour feminist, and she believed something that we must all hold dear, which is that when women work together, they can achieve more than they achieve on their own. That is a truth that has, I suppose, defined the progress that the Labour Party has made on women's representation. It was Labour women organising in the 80s and 90s that secured the rule changes that meant that we are now within sight of 50-50 representation within the Labour Party in Parliament. And it's really important to remember that every advance that's ever been got for women has only been achieved when women have got together and demanded it. And it's despite that, though, that today we still find ourselves in a situation in the Labour Party where there is still a problem that we need to fight. And that is what the Labour Women's Network tries to do. If you think that women now make up, I think, more than half of the membership of the Labour Party, when you look at leadership positions across the Labour Party, women's representation falls away. So just 16% of Labour local government leaders are women. We've never elected a woman to lead the Labour Party. There's only been a handful of women chairs of the Parliamentary Labour Party. Only 11% of senior staff in the Labour Party are women. So despite the huge progress we have made, there is a leadership gap when it comes to women's representation, which is why the Labour Women's Network is currently running a campaign called Time to Lead, which does three things. First of all, we're campaigning to the leadership to demand that they keep their promises that they made to us over the summer in the leadership contest to deliver rule changes, to deliver a comprehensive policy against sexual harassment in the Labour Party and across politics, to make sure that there's gender balance in the shadow cabinet and across elected committees. The second thing that we're doing is we're asking people to share their power. Well, we're demanding that people share their power. We have something called the Power Pledge, where we are going around to local constituency parties and we're saying, if you're a CLP chair, why is it that you're organising a meeting that's only got male speakers? Why is it that you're not supporting the positive action measures that have been proven to be so successful in the Labour Party? And then the third thing that we're doing is our training programme, because whilst we shouldn't have to run a training programme that has to build women back up from the kind of experiences that they have, unfortunately, through to sexism and misogyny in politics more widely, we do. So we train women locally from local training sessions in local CLPs, just explaining what the Labour Party is and how to get involved in politics, to training sessions for people who want to become leaders of their council, through to our aspiring parliamentary candidates programme. And our training programme has been very successful, and a number of our graduates are now in Parliament, which we see as a great success. And one thing I would say, I've got to give you an action today, and I'm bound to say this, but if you are Labour-minded, please do consider joining the Labour Women's Network and help us in one of those three parts of our campaign to ensure that Labour women can lead. I want to finish on a quote which we emblazoned on the side of our mugs that we were selling at Labour Party conference to try and make money for our campaigning activities in the year ahead. And the quote read, it's from Barbara Castle, it said, "In politics, guts is all." I really like that quote because it's honest. Politics is not easy, and as women in politics, there'll be a lot of challenges. But if you fight for something, if you believe in something, you have to fight for it. And I think the thing that we all have to take away is that, you know, we know what we stand for, whether you're in the Labour Party or in a different political party. If you believe in something, you have to fight for it, and that means you will face challenges. But sometimes it's easy to say, there's all these horrendous challenges, there's this horrendous sexism, it's too hard to do it. But if you look around the room today, all these fantastic women, all the strength you need is here. Solidarity and sisterhood is the most crucial weapon that we have. It is what has made us succeed over the years, and it is what will continue to make us succeed as we win the fight for women's equality. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Olivia. It's such a cheering note that all the strength we need is here in this room, and that's absolutely true. Congratulations on the great work you've done, not least for raising the tone of Labour mugs, and which don't have an entirely sort of distinguished history. Our next speaker is Baroness Anne Jenkin. Anne is a Conservative peer who co-founded the campaign group Women to Win with Theresa May in November 2005, that on its own terms, given that we have Britain's second woman prime minister, must be judged a resounding success. We're delighted to have you here today.
Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me this morning. I didn't know Jo very well, but of course I had every expectation that I'd have the chance to get to know her better. The first time we talked, it was about her idea to set up a go-to women's think tank, which didn't happen because she got selected for Batley and Spen. The second time she got in touch was to introduce me to a friend of hers who wanted to be a Conservative MP. Not everyone in politics shares their friends so generously. So we talked about women in politics, challenges for parties, challenges for women, challenges for members who select the candidates. And her loss is keenly felt amongst all of us here today and who are involved in this space, as well as so many others. Like everyone here today, I hope her legacy will be more women coming forward, getting selected and getting elected at every level of public life. Women to Win, founded with Theresa almost 11 years ago, is a campaign to get more Conservative women into Parliament. In 2005, we were stuck at 9% of the parliamentary party, just 17 women MPs. And today we have 68 women, just over 20%, not good enough, but a massive improvement. So like the other organisations, we headhunt, encourage, mentor, support, and by hook or crook, persuade our members to select capable Conservative women candidates. We rattle the cage. We provide one-on-one support, group practice, speaking practice, Q&A practice, and mentors, and often male because they are more competitive. I got my woman a candidate, an interview, you didn't get yours. At every level. We need to work harder on outreach as the numbers coming forward to even start the journey are still far lower than the men. Our profile at conference was high this year with at least four mentions from the main platform. As she always does, Theresa attended our reception on the Sunday night and we ran a successful Getting Started high-level panel addressing a jam-packed room despite an 8 a.m. start. Our director, Gillian Keegan, and I presented our new film, Daughters, from the conference platform at a members-only session. The idea for the film, which is available on our website, came from the male MPs who feature in it. Supporters of our campaign, some with daughters already in the workplace who are conscious of bias, some with younger daughters who can imagine prejudice in the future. Male MPs who can see that Parliament functions so much better with a proper mix and have come to realise how much harder it is for women to get selected and to thrive in the Westminster environment. They too want a level playing field, and I hope that by showing this film to influential senior Conservatives, we are more likely to get that. My call for action is similar to the others. Either volunteer to be a mentor or find one and encourage more capable women to step up to the plate. I often think about how near impossible it would be for, say, a small businesswoman from a politically difficult place, I mean geographically, who has what it takes, is resilient, and knows why she wants to be an MP. How does that woman start to navigate the maze to Westminster? I want to help her by providing someone to hold her hand through the process. So male or female, and again, buy-in from men is important. Please either help a capable woman or find someone else who will. You know, I'm still today asked sometimes, why does it matter? Why does it matter if it's 9%, 20%, 29% as we have across Parliament? And in the end, it's quite simple. Women's life experiences are different to men. They're not inferior or not superior, but they are just different. And we have to have that difference better reflected in the Westminster bubble. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne, both for your memories of Jo and for the encouragement you offer to everyone here today. And I move now to our final speaker in this half of the proceedings. The Right Honourable John Bercow MP is the MP for Buckingham, the Speaker of the House of Commons, and I think it's fair to say somebody who's seen at first hand more male misogyny at work than most people would care to experience in a lifetime. As part of his role, he does a great deal of work behind the scenes for charities and so on, as I know, but he's also charged with diversity and with broadening that. John Bercow, delighted to have you here.
Mary, thank you for the warmth and generosity of that welcome. And can I underline what so many others have said in respect of their own situations, namely that I feel very proud and honoured to be invited to be amongst your number this morning. When the House of Commons met on the 20th of June, in shock, outrage, and undiluted misery, I said on that occasion that Jo Cox had been filled with and fueled by a love for humanity. If I had to distill and identify in a sentence what I thought was her most striking and resonant characteristic, that was it. And that radiant humanitarianism shone and percolated through everything she said and did in her all too short tenure as a member of the House of Commons. Now, my friends and colleagues, I don't seek to appear before you under false pretenses, both because that would be unethical and because you're an august and discerning bunch and you would soon see through it. There are people in the House of Commons, Ali McGovern and Rachel Reeves prominent amongst them, but others to boot, who can say that they were really good, long-standing, close friends of Jo. I make no such claim. I got to know Jo, as perhaps you might expect, when and only when she was elected to the Commons in May 2015. And of course, in the aftermath of a tragedy, it is almost simply good manners to find something obliging to say about someone who has departed in such appalling circumstances. It wasn't difficult in this case. It was a question of what to exclude rather than of what to include. And I refer to that radiant humanitarianism. And that radiant humanitarianism was at the root of what I suppose was the single most striking belief of Jo, and that was a belief in equality, human rights, and social justice. And that belief in equality, human rights, and social justice motored Jo in everything she did. And it was evident, therefore, in her repeated pleas for action to fight global poverty and to try to rescue from the utter destitution a billion people across the globe. People who don't actually, in any meaningful sense, by our standards, friends and colleagues, live, but who struggle against the odds to eke out what passes for an existence. That belief in equality, human rights, and social justice was at the heart, of course, of her repeated, articulate, and unforgettable pleas for action to address the horrific slaughter taking place in Syria. And although deeply Labour, utterly committed to her party, Jo was not just ready, but raring to work with others, as the Americans would say, across the aisle who shared that belief. Hence, her good working relationship with Andrew Mitchell, which he very amusingly and graciously acknowledged on the 20th of June, might not have seemed the most obvious link-up. But tribalism didn't come into it for Jo. It was a question of forging links, building alliances, establishing relationships with people like-minded on that matter. For to do otherwise would not just be a missed opportunity, but really a truly chronic self-indulgence, because she took the view, well, it's not about me, and it's not about Andrew, and it's not about my party or his party, it's about our cause. And a similar mindset, an instinctive as opposed to a contrived mindset, was at work in her passion for human rights, peace, the rule of law, freedom, and justice in Burma, a country I mention en passant because before Jo came to be a Member of Parliament, she served for some considerable time on the board of the Burma Campaign UK. And you can see why when you reflect on the savage military despotism that afflicted that country for 60 years until a matter of months ago. So she was and remains for all of us a very special person. She was eloquent and principled, warm and wise. She was insistent, and I pick up on something that Olivia Bailey said, which I thought was very, very significant. It's very gritty, but has to be said. There will always be a battle, to some degree, to advance your own cause and to press successfully a political cause in which you believe, both because of the existence of people who genuinely disagree with you and because the process of policy making and of government and of overcoming external forces is necessarily and almost inexorably difficult and challenging. Now, soon you're going to hear from Julia Gillard, and wow, what pulling power you've got that you've been able to attract Julia to speak to you and to be with you today. Now, I don't know Julia personally, but I do know that in a 15-year career in Parliament, she was the first leader of her party, first Deputy Prime Minister, first Prime Minister, first person to hold all those three offices. And of course, she was a minister before she became Prime Minister with very important responsibilities. And we will all recall that just as Jo was conscious of online abuse in the UK, particularly faced and endured by women, Julia had to put up with bigotry in the form of sexism and misogyny on a truly industrial scale throughout her career. Now, no doubt, to have got to the point that she did, she is extremely robust and resilient and a person of enormous character. But you shouldn't have to put up with that sort of abuse. And it was a subject on which so eloquently Yvette Cooper was speaking when I entered the room some 20 minutes or so ago. I've nothing to add on that front. I just want really to conclude my little contribution by saying this. On the day that we met to honour and pay tribute to Jo in the company of the quite extraordinarily brave Brendan Cox and the family, speaker after speaker after speaker said, this has got to spawn a culture change. There has to be a legacy of Jo. And of course, you could say, particularly, though not only if you're a politician of the left, well, that legacy should be a commitment to collective endeavour, to the we as well as the me, to recognising the need for solidarity in the political space. But at a more simple level, the message could be, the lesson could be, the message and the lesson should be, let's think about doing our politics differently, vigorously, with passion, sometimes almost inevitably, friends, colleagues, entailing anger, that's always been true in politics, but not in a way that is characterized and dominated by an instinctive tendency to rubbish and malign the motives of anybody who happens to hold and express an opinion that differs from our own. No names, no pack drill, but I saw people nodding along with that thought that so many speakers put from the floor of the House, and it lasted. My friends, it lasted, I'm sorry to say, for about a week. And we're now back into the same old ways. Now, you could look at me and say, well, John, it's up to you to do better. And it is, to identify examples of abuse and to tackle them, and always to be thinking, don't call, and I try always to avoid calling half a dozen men in a row, I'm always looking to call women to speak, who, and women do, just as a matter of fact, on the whole, behave better in Parliament than men, because the bad behaviour is a mixture of yobbery and public school twittishness. And that is mainly the men. I once said that in a speech, and I got an angry letter from the head of the Headmasters Conference, the group of public schools, saying that it was quite inappropriate and thoroughly offensive, and he demanded that I retract. And of course, I was prepared to do nothing of the kind. I'm always prepared to admit when I get it wrong, but I didn't get it wrong. I was right. And it still goes on. Now, people have either got to resolve to change the character or not. I can deal with the manifestations of disorder, but I can't bring about a complete culture change. If the party leaders really want behaviour to change in Parliament, it will, and if they don't, it won't. Two final thoughts, and then I promise you, I will shut up. Okay, two final thoughts, and I will shut up. First, this. Just before the recess, I noticed, Mary, my friends, Nia Griffith, Labour MP, speaking in the House, and the Secretary of State for Defence, Michael Fallon, was on the front bench, and there was a junior, middle-ranking minister sitting next to him, wittering away at him uninterruptedly. So I waited for a few minutes to see if this would stop, and it didn't. And finally, I'm afraid, somewhat exasperated, I stood up and said, "Order, I apologise for interrupting the Honourable Lady as she's addressing the House. But I say to the Secretary of State for Defence, as far as I'm aware, the Right Honourable Gentleman is answering the debate this evening," and he nodded. And I said, in which case it would be quite a good idea if he were listening to it. But it's difficult for him to do so because the Honourable Gentleman next to him has been wittering away at him for several minutes. I can't prove that he wouldn't have done that if a man was speaking, but I have a firm conviction that neither of them was remotely interested in what this female member of Parliament had to say to the House. Now, that has to change. And my last observation is that Sarah Charles has just produced a fantastic report called The Good Parliament, which is about, it has great buy-in from across the House, about how we can change the culture in the House, in the chamber, within the building, making us a more gender-sensitive Parliament. And surely part of Jo's legacy has to be the creation of a more respectful, honourable, gender-sensitive House of Commons. Mary, you have been extremely tolerant. Can I wish you a great conference and a great day and great years ahead? Thank you very much.
John, thank you. Thank you so much for an inspiring contribution. And it's completely true, of course, that Parliament does so easily default to its own ways. But like John and like all the people who've spoken today, I do really believe that the memory of Jo Cox does have a power to make a difference, that her love of humanity, for which John, about which John rightly spoke, really can help to effect change, and equally the memory of shock and of outrage is also, I think, an accelerator and an engine of the sort of change that everybody in this room wants to see. I thank so much the wonderful array of speakers we've had today who do so much to inspire faith in women, in public life, in diversity, in justice, in all the ingredients of a healthy and a functioning democracy. So thank you all, and I'm going to hand over now to my journalistic colleague, Sonia Soda, who is the chief leader writer of the Observer newspaper, who will in turn introduce Julia Gillard, to whom I also extend a huge welcome and thanks. So thank you all.
Hi everyone. Well, it is a huge honour to be able to welcome Julia Gillard to the event today. She doesn't really need an introduction, but I'm going to give her a brief one. She served as the Labour Prime Minister of Australia between 2010 and 2013. She was Australia's first and remains Australia's only female Prime Minister. And she's also the only woman to have ever led a major political party in Australia. And I'm sure I'm not the only woman in this room who is cheering her on when we watched her impassioned takedown of Tony Abbott in the House of Representatives on the nature of modern misogyny. If anyone hasn't seen it, I'd recommend you take a look on YouTube. I checked last night, almost 3 million views, although I'm sure that one of those views didn't come from a certain stateside presidential candidate who could do with watching the speech, I think. So, Julia, I'm really excited, like I'm sure everyone else in the room is, to hear about some of your insights as a woman in public life and some of the advice you've got to offer.
Thank you very much for that welcome. Each of us is here today because we believe in promoting more women who are committed to equality for their sisters into public life. And all of us are here today because we understand that we can best achieve this goal by working together. And of course, we are here to honour the memory of one great female politician who absolutely endorsed, who would have absolutely endorsed this celebration of unity and purpose, Jo Cox. Together, unity, these were values that drove Jo in all that she did. She believed in a world that celebrated and reflected our common humanity. She believed in a nation that was united and welcomed diversity. Jo fought for togetherness, for unity throughout her life. As head of policy for Oxfam, she had comforted victims of rape in Darfur, met child soldiers in Uganda, and empathised with the hopes and fears of elders in Afghanistan, all people who had borne witness to the very worst consequences of allowing our differences to divide us. In politics, Jo brought her passion for togetherness into everything that she did. As you can see on the screen above, in her maiden speech in the House of Commons, she proclaimed to the chamber that while she loved the fact that her constituency of Batley and Spen celebrated its diversity, in Jo's words, we are far more united and have far more in common with each other than things that divide us. Jo was devastated by the conflict in Syria and took personally the lack of urgency and compassion that was characterising foreign policy debates over Britain's role as a global power and the responsibilities that came with it. She feared for the children of refugees, for their future, their safety, and their health and education. These were issues that she felt strongly enough about to challenge her party and to challenge the Prime Minister. In doing so, she changed the foreign policy of this country. In the midst of the toxic politics that too often characterised Brexit, Jo continued her personal crusade for togetherness. She believed in the Remain position because she believed Britain, the United Kingdom, was stronger in the European Union than out. She believed unity equaled strength. This concept of togetherness was something that defined Jo. It was a value which she fought for in the community and throughout her career. Tragically, it was a cause that cost Jo her life far too terribly and far too soon. Like millions of others around the world, I remember where I was when I heard of Jo's death. I was in a hotel room in Brussels, and unusually for me, I had the television on. Normally, I get my news online, but I was there sorting through documents and the other stuff that I had accumulated on the trip. I flicked the television on just for background noise, but on hearing about Jo, I stopped moving around the room. I sank on the bed and watched, saddened, stricken, and shuddering about what this said about our world. Women friends of mine who were campaigning at exactly the same time in Australia's election were particularly shaken. They wondered, what does this mean for us now? Standing at street stalls and giving out pamphlets at train stations, they asked themselves for the first time ever, are we safe? How do those who love Jo recover? How do we all move beyond the shock and fear? My answer is that while we must farewell Jo, we must never farewell the values that defined her. Jo lives on through those who loved her, those who miss her, and through all of us that share her passion for social solidarity as we choose to step up and serve in public life. I've been asked today to give you an honest account of the reality of being in politics. The most important truth is one Jo understood so well. Politics enables us to drive and deliver real progress. If you are driven by a sense of purpose, as she was, politics and the pursuit of power enables you to achieve your dreams for your society. Activism is wonderful and it serves an important role for our democracy. But if you want to see real change and you want to see it endure, then politics is where you need to be. This is why Jo herself made the transition from campaigner to MP. I genuinely believe that politics is a noble calling, not a grubby necessary evil. We are so incredibly fortunate to live in free and fair democracies where we have the right to run for parliament. Jo was an exceptional person, there's no doubt about it, but she wasn't unique and she would have been the first person to say so. There are so many women in our communities who could serve with distinction. We need to help them get into parliament and to be proud to be political. Of course, this isn't just about numbers and it's not about having a go, it's about results. Women need power to change things. You can't change things if you are a name on a ballot paper, a quota filled. You need your seat in parliament. Participation is the start, but power is the end. Jo knew that. It's why she worked so hard across party lines to make sure that women were running for seats that they could win. And it's why she herself joined a party where she stood a shot of becoming an MP and one day a minister, even a prime minister. Jo had courage, but she was also unashamed to have ambition. She wanted to go far, and she wanted to lift up others as she climbed. There's no stain in aspiring to the highest office in your country. It doesn't taint the purity of your purpose. Today, I want to say to you loudly and clearly, have the highest ambitions for yourself, for your purpose. Jo believed Britain could be a force for change in the world, and she fought for that. I know what it's like to have power, to combine it with a sense of purpose and to deliver results. Whether it was improving our schools, introducing a national disability insurance scheme, or establishing the Royal Commission into Institutional Child Sexual Abuse, I was able to deliver on issues that mattered hugely to me and to the future of my country. When I left the Prime Ministership, I immediately leapt into writing my memoirs. It was important for me to do this early, while the feelings, experiences and memories were fresh, and my reactions unsullied by the passage of time. In doing so, I had to look back unflinchingly at my own time in politics. I had to unpack the highs and lows, the achievements and misses, the brutal politics, the incredible opportunities, and of course the way I experienced it all as a person and as a woman. I wanted, as I wrote, to send a strong message to young women contemplating politics, and that message is: define your sense of purpose, nurture your sense of self, and go for it. But as you forge ahead, understand that you will encounter sexism and misogyny, and prepare yourself to face it and ultimately to eradicate it. Let me share with you what gender discrimination can look and feel like. As Prime Minister, day after day, time after time, I would find myself in a room, often a business boardroom, where I was the only woman, apart perhaps from a woman serving coffee or food. Because politics at senior levels in my nation and yours has been almost always the pursuit of men, the assumptions of politics have been defined around men's lives, not women's lives. It is assumed a man with children brings to politics the perspective of a family man, but it is never suggested that he should be disqualified from the rigours of political life because he has caring responsibilities. This definitely does not work the same way for women. Even before becoming Prime Minister, I had observed that if you are a woman politician, it is impossible to win on the question of family. If you do not have children, then you are characterised as out of touch with mainstream lives. If you do have children, then heavens, who's looking after them? I had already been chided by a senior Conservative senator for being deliberately barren, and then had to stomach reading follow-up pieces like the one entitled Barren Behaviour in one of our two national newspapers, which stated, and I quote, "At the Junie abattoir, manager Heath Newton knows what happens in the bush to a barren cow. It's just a case where if they're infertile, they get sent to the vet to get checked and then killed as hamburger mince," he says. In the Kimberley region near Broome, where Senator Heffernan issued his public apology for his remarks on Wednesday night, the barren cows even have a name: killers. It's the ultimate fate of an animal that can't breed. Before becoming Prime Minister, I'd also worked out that what you are wearing will draw disproportionate attention. It did when I became Deputy Leader of the Opposition, pleading, "I like to wear suits," or "I have been on the road for days," simply did not cut it. Undoubtedly, a male leader who does not meet a certain standard will be marked down, but that standard is such an obvious one: of regular weight, a well-tailored suit, neat hair, television-friendly glasses, trimmed eyebrows. Being the first female Prime Minister, I had to navigate what that standard was for a woman. It is galling to me that when I first met NATO's leader, predominantly to discuss our strategy for the war in Afghanistan, where our troops, Australian troops, as well as yours, were fighting and dying, it was reported in the following terms. Quote, "The Prime Minister, Julia Gillard, has made her first appearance on the international stage, meeting the head of NATO, Anders Rasmussen, in Brussels. Dressed in a white short jacket and dark trousers, she appeared at the security organisation's headquarters just after 9 a.m. European time and was ushered in by Mr. Rasmussen, the former Danish Prime Minister and NATO Secretary General," end quote. This article was written by a female journalist. It apparently went without saying that Mr. Rasmussen was wearing a suit. On another occasion, whilst in a bilateral meeting with the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, at the Earth Summit in Rio, a respected female journalist opened her article with, quote, "As well as matters of state, US Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and Prime Minister Julia Gillard have had a chat about their hairstyles." Six paragraphs then followed on the matter of our respective hairstyles. Now, this gender stereotyping was at the very benign end compared to much of what I faced, Ditch the witch on placards at rallies, the ugly ravings about how women are destroying the joint from a conservative and cantankerous radio shock jock, the pornographic cartoons circulated by an eccentric bankrupt, the vile words on social media. It might be easy and comforting for you to conclude that this is all something about the treatment of women in Australia. I regret doing this, but I'm going to have to disabuse you of that notion. Indeed, some of the sexist insults thrown at me were not original. Rather, they had originally been hurled at Hillary Clinton when she first ran to be the Democrats' nominee for president in 2008. Sadly, the current presidential campaign in the United States is showing us that this sort of gender discrimination isn't set to leave us anytime soon. A Washington Post analysis that looked at 100,000 tweets made during the New Hampshire primary found the most gendered words used about Secretary Clinton were a common swear word starting with B, a reference to sexual organs, including a word starting with C, and the term rapist, including threats that she should be raped. For Mr. Sanders, dad and basketball were as gendered as it got. Donald Trump today labels her as lying Hillary, crooked Hillary, and he appeared to give a subtle endorsement to the use of violence against her at one of his rallies, where it has become routine for the crowd to shout, "Lock her up," or even "String her up." In this week's debate, he embraced the spirit of these chants, saying Secretary Clinton should be in jail. While not as dramatic or coarse, we've already seen Prime Minister May's appearance and childlessness be the subject of focus. Obviously, anyone contending for high office has to be scrutinised and tested, and no gender analysis should be taken to mean that female candidates should be immune from criticism. But these gendered references are the antithesis of valid critiques, and there is a responsibility that lies on everyone's shoulders, men and women, to make sure in any political campaign that criticism is not gender-based, that it is not about precluding a woman from leading simply because she is a woman. Beyond sexism, there are other very real risks that women in public life must face, and I fear that those are much greater than they were when I commenced my own journey into public life. Violence against women is nothing new in our world. Conservative estimates tell us that at least one in three women will experience physical or sexual violence in her lifetime. These statistics traverse geography, race, and age. In the United Kingdom, the number of violent offences against women, including domestic abuse, rape, and sexual assault, rose by almost 10% in 2015-16. Now threats of violence have become more prevalent for women in public life. Once upon a time, to criticise a public figure, you generally had to put your name to that criticism, be it a letter to the editor, a confrontation at a town hall meeting, a considered critique delivered on screen, or a view written in a newspaper. Now, both seasoned commentators and the general public can say what they like, protected by the anonymity of the Twitter handle. They have the power to fire barbs directly at their targets without any fear of consequence. At best, these can be snarky and occasionally witty criticisms of a politician's decisions or actions. At worst, they can take the form of detailed death threats or threats of violence against family, friends, and staff. And of course, as a woman in public life, the violent threats take on another sickening dimension. Threats of violent abuse, of rape, are far too common. A woman in public view may expect to receive them almost daily. In the United Kingdom, the numbers of cases of extremely offensive online abuse against women is sharply rising, despite concerted efforts to highlight and challenge this type of abuse. I commend The Guardian's The Web We Want campaign and the cross-party Reclaim the Internet campaign. This work represents important first steps, but there is much more that needs to be done to stem this flow of abuse that so disproportionately impacts women. Our community would not consider it acceptable to yell violent, sexually charged abuse at a female politician walking down the street. Why is it okay to let these voices ring so loudly in our online world? These voices weaken, ridicule, humiliate, and terrify. Not only do they challenge the resolve of women who cop the abuse, but they deter other women from raising their hand to serve in public life. For all the structural barriers to women's participation in politics and for all the gender bias and sexism that must be addressed, so too must we challenge and defeat the online abuse. We don't yet know to what extent online abuse translates into physical violence, but I am certain that the connection is real, that women feel and fear it, and that it is preventing women from standing up and serving in public life. All this needs to change, and in this room we have the power to change it. When we reflect on what feminism has already achieved for women, voting rights, anti-discrimination laws, education, workplace rights, financial freedoms, better policing of crimes against women, and the list goes on, we should be fortified and inspired by what we are capable of achieving next. Jo Cox's purpose in public life was togetherness. She wanted to see a world that was more fair, more safe, and much less divided. Through her work, she delivered on this purpose. The world truly is a better place because of Jo's service. Let her purpose serve as the inspiration for us to fulfil our own. Let her fearlessness give us the strength and courage to serve in public life, notwithstanding all that we know about its potential perils and dangers. Let her ambition and pride in her work be our own. And for women like myself who have already experienced the great opportunities of public life, let us stand in solidarity with the next generation of women and support their right to serve and lead safely and freely, but most importantly, powerfully. I thank you.
Thank you so much for that really inspiring call to action, Julia. We've got about 20 minutes now for questions to Julia, so I'd like to open it out to the floor. I'll take questions in threes. Lady at the back there. Is there a mic? Or do people just have to shout? I think you might need to, sorry.
Yes, I have. Sorry, we're going to take three, were we? Or do you want me to answer that question?
You go ahead and answer.
Okay, thank you. Look, yes, I have seen some of that, but I must admit I am a bit reluctant to stereotype male leadership and female leadership into doctrinaire a way. I think individuals lead differently, and the historic model of leadership, the model of leadership in which we tended to see so many men, has been a command and control style of leadership. And now the world has changed. And, you know, whether it's in management structures, civil service structures, you've got, you know, flatter, more consultative ways, more networked ways of doing things. And so I think the way in which people look to their leaders to respond is different than in the past. Now, there's always going to be a role for command and control leadership. You know, in combat where you need to take that hill, someone has to be the leader. In an emergency situation where someone has to coordinate those fire trucks, those ambulances, you need a leader in a command and control mode. But most of leadership these days is this networked collaborative leadership. And I think men and women can definitely inspire in both styles of leadership. I think in terms of the other aspect of kind of male traits, I do think, and I've certainly felt that obligation very clearly when I was in office, that you know that there is a stereotype out there in people's heads that, you know, women can't take it, that it's too tough. And so I think women, particularly the first, you do feel the pressure to kind of harden your heart and, you know, visibly tough it out. And in doing that, maybe people sense a more, you know, male demeanour in your performance. But I do think there is a pressure on women who are going in the early ranks into leadership to not look like they can't take it. But the more we equalise and the more women we have, then the more we've normalised male and female leadership, I think we'll see a diversity of styles on display, and that'll be a great thing.
Thank you. Any more questions? Lady over there.
I'm told it now works.
Thank you so much for what all the speakers have said today. Can you describe how you manage with the levels of abuse and threats of violence? Because I really think that this is a major, major issue for women, either being online or being in public, that the threat of violence, how do you deal with that?
I think it is really important to kind of nurture a sense of self. So let me talk about sort of criticisms online first and then come to actual threats of violence. On criticisms online first or in the public debate, I think it is really important for women and men, but particularly women, to nurture a sense of self that is very strong and resilient. And you don't have to be in public life for this to be a challenge. I mean, there, you know, in this wonderful city of London, there will have been teenage girls last night who were looking at things said about them on social media that were highly distressing. And if you contract out your sense of self to the ups and downs of the online environment, or if you're in politics, the ups and downs of the media environment, then that's a recipe for being on an emotional roller coaster that I don't think anybody can actually tolerate. I had the opportunity to watch some other women in politics, and by the time I got there, I was very clear in my mind that, you know, I am the same bundle of strengths and weaknesses on a day that headlines are saying wonderful things about me and a day headlines are saying bad things about me. And I can't afford to feel good on the first day and bad on the second day. So nurturing that sense of self's important. None of that means you should be, you know, immune to the constructive criticisms of others, but people you respect. But, you know, if it comes in on Twitter after midnight, as I've frequently said, it's fuelled by alcohol, not acumen, and we really shouldn't let that get in our head. On direct threats of violence, I think it comes back to the work that Yvette's doing and that is emerging here. We do need to have societal norms that we would expect to be policed in face-to-face interactions, have them policed in the same way in online interactions. If someone yelled a death threat at me now, and I'm not encouraging you to do so, but if someone yelled a death threat at me now, that would, you know, I could identify the person, the police could become involved. You can't do things like that. We all know you can't do things like that. And so I think we do have to sharpen up actually the policing response for some of the most vile things that get said online.
Lady Evelyn.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask you about how women can develop and maintain an authentic voice in politics. So I think all of us will have responded to your barnstorming speech, which felt was you, was really very much about you. And I feel that when I encounter women in politics in spaces like at the Labour Women's Network or at Women's Conference or whatever, they speak quite differently sometimes, and that we... you operate in a world sort of filtered through media or whatever, which dampens those authentic voices, constrains them. And we can see how Hillary Clinton is being constrained in so many ways in that discourse, so that her authenticity, I feel, it's very difficult to come through. So how do we develop those authentic voices that speak to everyone out there in the real world and connect with them in a way that I think often politicians fail to because it's so mannered and constrained? Sorry, I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, no, it does make sense. And I've heard Hillary joke in person that, you know, the essence of being in modern politics is someone says to you as you go out for a public engagement, you know, do say this, definitely don't say that. Now, just, you know, be yourself. But I would be reluctant to say that this is just a pressure on women. And I wonder whether in public life we tend to more quickly default to the position that a woman is being handled and managed rather than recognising that this is a political phenomenon in the modern age. David Cameron as Prime Minister here would have had a suite of advisers, including media advisers. I mean, we know he had media advisers. That would have gone through exactly the same style preparation processes that Hillary Clinton went through or that I went through in Australian politics. And yet it's quite easy for people to default to saying, well, the women are, you know, inauthentic and somehow the men have got authenticity. I just actually think modern politics is really, really hard. And the price of a misstatement, even a little, bumble of your words, a misspeak. The price of that in this interconnected, turbocharged media environment world is a huge one. And, you know, consequently, politicians do increasingly watch every word. At the same time, the media, because they know that it's the shrillest stuff that sells, are always looking for the moment of parody, and so politicians have become more controlled to involve, you know, avoid that moment of parody, either getting caught for a photograph under an exit sign or when someone is being rude to you, even though 500 people have been nice to you, you know, the only thing that's going to run is the person who's rude to you. So politics has become more controlled, politicians have become more controlled. I actually think the next kind of act is the one that's emerging now, where politicians are deviating around the media and generating their own online content. It's not much remarked, but it should be. I mean, in this presidential campaign, both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump announced their vice presidential candidates by tweet. They're just going around the media and generating their own content. Now, maybe actually some of the things that politicians have learned to do to thrive in a combative media environment, they will actually be alleviated from as they get to control some of their own content and be more direct with the public. But at the end of the day, I would prefer Hillary Clinton's deep thoughtfulness than the alternative.
As I'm sure would many people in this room. Over there, lady over there. Do you mind if I take three questions so we get as many as possible?
Hi, Julia. I know a lot of brilliant senior women who said they struggled to get to the very top because they lack access to the kind of informal male boys' clubs networks that often help each other out in those situations. So my question is, how did you get a seat around the table and make sure your voice was heard at senior level?
And I'm just going to take a couple more questions to make sure we can get quite a few. And there's someone over here.
It's just a question related to solidarity. Very much related to your profession. I'm in a profession where I've been in 10 years, and the dropout of females is so high. And when I talk to females who have left, they say, well, I feel differently now, or when I had children, I couldn't find my place back in the world of work, and I wasn't accepted in the same way because I had different expectations forcing me. How do you navigate that, and how do you ensure a sense of solidarity among women? Because there aren't enough of the women who have a shared experience remaining in that particular environment.
And there was one question back there, and this is going to be the last question, really, sorry.
Hi. I'm wondering if you would think it would be useful for more women politicians to describe themselves as feminists. And I think we had Barack Obama and Justin Trudeau do it in the last couple of months. And I'm wondering whether you think that would be useful.
Well, thank you for those questions, and I'm happy to answer them. I'll start with the last one first. I think the word feminist is a very important word. And whenever I'm asked to define it, because I do think in some people's imaginations, it's come to have this baggage put on it. But when I'm asked to define it, I default to that wonderful American expression, do the math. You know how they wander around going, do the math. Why they don't wander around going, do the maths, is one of those great great mysteries of our age. But if you believe, as I do, that merit is equally distributed between the sexes, and you can look at any structure and not see around about half-half, then it's got to have meant that women of merit didn't get there. And it does mean some men got there who shouldn't have, if it was an equal playing field. And in this crowded, contested world with so many hard issues, why in any sphere of life would you want less than your best team on the field? Whether it's running your business, at a judicial bench, in a cabinet, in a parliament, running a civil society organisation, why would you want less than your best team on the field? And of course, that same analysis about gender applies for diversity more broadly. Why would you want less than your best team on the field? I feel like the word feminism is now being repopularised and coming back into vogue, and I'm glad to see that. I think there was an era when feminism was seen to be so aligned with progressive political parties and movements that it was a word that conservatives wouldn't use. I think it's good that conservatives will use the word, that your prime minister uses the word. My prime minister, who is a conservative, has described himself as a feminist. I think it's good that we've got that word, you know, back out there, and we should be proud of it. On male power structures, though, what our theory of feminism definitely teaches us is that there are networks, both formal and informal, that sustain people and offer them the next opportunity. I think there's, you know, some things that we know about structural barriers in public life and working life that we've just got to get really determined about fixing, or even more determined than we have been, and the inability still for women and men, but given caring responsibilities tend to fall on the shoulders of women, women in particular, to negotiate career paths when they've got caring responsibilities. It's a structural issue, and we have to fix it and should fix it. But there are also these subtle issues of networking and unconscious bias. And in my period post-Parliament, I've been really drawn to looking at the, you know, research about unconscious bias, the stereotypes that are still whispering in all of our heads, which tell us things like a male leader is quite likely to be likeable, but when we look at a female leader, we quite quickly conclude she's not likeable. This is a stereotype whispering to us. And we've got to understand these unconscious biases and bust them down. And we've got to understand this pattern of networks and male power structures. And I think a transformative thing we've got to focus on with those power structures is it's become very common for women to ask to be mentored and for men to step up and say, yes, they'll engage in the mentoring. But I think we need to do the next stage, particularly looking at the business community, but not just it, which is there is a difference between mentoring and career sponsorship. And career sponsorship, mentoring is kind of good, imparting skills and perspectives, but career sponsorship actually has some real skin in the game. You know, if I am quite senior management but not the CEO and I recommend one of you for promotion, if you go well, tick for me. If you go badly, that's a problem for me. So in making that selection of who I'm going to actually sponsor, I've got some real skin in that game. And the research would tell us that when it comes to that moment of, am I going to put myself a little bit at risk in this career sponsorship moment, that people tend to select people who are very like themselves, and men disproportionately select men. So if we're going to bust these sort of power networks open, we're going to actually have to up the demand from mentoring to this very explicit request around career sponsorship to find the pathways through for women from the middle management realm or in Parliament, the backbench or junior ministry realm into the next bit of it. For me, I think there was a combination of things that enabled me to come through. I mean, it's a forgotten story now, but in a grand Labor Party tradition, I sought pre-selection for over 10 years and was unsuccessful. I've lost count of how many times I stood for pre-selection and didn't get pre-selected. So that's a story in telling you perhaps your first foray into the power structures isn't necessarily a successful one. But I ultimately ended up with the support of some incredible men and women, creating our own little faction that then negotiated the deals and arrangements which enabled me to come through into Parliament and then in what was a time of change in the Labor Party in Australia for women's pre-selection and women's outlooks to come through. Part of it is, yes, you know, I was blessed by the era in which I went into politics. It was an era in which people were thinking, because we'd forced it onto the agenda, about women in politics. But it is also a story of, you know, taking political steps in a political party in a highly political way and not being ashamed of that. All the feminist kind of sayings, the don't be too polite girls, well-behaved women rarely make history. In all of those sayings, I do think we have to remind ourselves that sometimes we put too much of a burden about purity on women in politics when politics is about getting access to the levers of power and then using them for good things. And the process of getting access to the levers of power is often not a pretty process and not one where your niceness can be at the forefront. Doesn't mean you shouldn't be nice, but you've got to be determined and you've got to be prepared to get in there and have a red hot go. I would say, you know, prepare yourself for that. This is, even with more women in politics, this is never going to be nirvana where people sit around singing Kumbaya. It's always going to be a bloody hard contest between contending visions of the future that is fought out in the House of Commons, that is fought out in the streets of this city and beyond in the rest of the United Kingdom, to win people's votes and confidence and to get in there and to push as necessary to make sure that you can get things changed. So, you know, we should admire the capacity to steel ourselves as much as we admire the capacity to define with clarity the purpose for which we are steeling ourselves, because it's got to be about purpose. And the shared purpose in this room is clearly one of equality.
Huge apologies to those of you who had questions who I didn't have time to get to, but the RSA want us out of the room at 11, unfortunately, so we have to draw the event to a close. I just want to end with a few thank yous before we end. First of all, a huge thank you to Julia for her inspiring and very honest words, and also to our other inspiring speakers that we've had today. I'd like to say a big thank you to Jo's friends who've organised this event in her loving memory, to Kirsty, to Nan, and to Eloise. I think one of the things that makes this event so much in the spirit of Jo is that we all leave with a practical to-do list. And so last, I'd like to say a huge thank you to all of you for coming. I counted 12 actions that our speakers took us through today. I'm not going to say all of them, but there are just a few that stood out for me. Give up power. If you're at the table, look around and see who isn't at the table and bring them in. Call yourself a campaigner. Don't be a bystander. Amplify women's voices. Ask a woman to run for election. And finally, in the words of Julia, define your sense of purpose, nurture your sense of self, and go for it.